It's Sunday night, and we're in a study about the sovereignty of God. Sovereign means to be controlling everything. Now, most people, when they think of the sovereignty of God, they think that God is a, I've heard them say this, to put down those of us who believe in predestination, they will say something along this line. They'll say, God is not a cosmic police officer standing up in the sky and dictating things and say, you don't do this, and you do this, and you do this. That's exactly what he is. He is a cosmic police officer, and he's the judge of all things, and he is sovereign. Sovereign means Lord over everything, the good and the evil. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about tonight, election. And what we were elected to, when you get into predestination, we are predestined to be conformed, to be conformed to the image of Christ, to his image. Of course, the word image is the word icon. We know that. And it means to the likeness of Jesus. And that's because we are unlike Jesus. We are not like him. We want to retain that old man that we used to be. There's nobody been more guilty of that than me. I used to have a real bad temper, and I'd get angry at everything, and I'd get angry at somebody cheating me. Now I don't believe in that. Now I believe that what you're supposed to do if somebody cheats you, just allow it. Give place to wrath. Give, in other words, allow it to happen, but then get out of their way and don't get in their way anymore. Whenever the Bible says, allow these things to happen, what it's talking about is don't fight people when they're beating you. First of all, in all probability, you've placed yourself in the path of anger and fury by trying to compete in a world or in some situation that you're not supposed to be there. We're predestined for whom he did foreknow. God had a people that he foreknew. Whom is the word whose. There's no H's. There's the diacritical mark. Has an H sound. And that's a masculine gender. Masculine means the whoms are a people. Most people try to excuse predestination, say, well, God knew what would happen. A what is a thing. It's neuter gender. That's a what. A whom is a people, for whom he did foreknow. He had a whoms that he prognosco. He knew us before the foundation of the world. Well, he had to, because Jesus was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Now, if he died before the world began in the mind of God, God already had it planned out. If he died, he had to be dying for somebody. He didn't die for everybody. That's one of the arguments against predestination. We believe in limited atonement. We believe that the atonement of Christ upon the cross, Christ on cross, was limited to his church, to his wife. Well, that's what the Bible says in Ephesians 5:25. Husbands, love your wives the same way Christ loved the church and gave himself for. It says it in the English Bible, but the word is auta. Ada on the end of the word is feminine gender. In fact, you don't even have to take my word for it. You look it up. Look up that verse, Ephesians 5:25. Look it up in the interlinear, and it'll show you it's the word Ada. And then take an analytical lexicon and look up the word aute, and it will tell you whenever it ends with an Ada, a word ends with an Ada, it's feminine gender. Well, it doesn't say, you can't call an it is a pronoun. But it's the pronouns, all the pronouns are I, we, you, he, she, it, they. All the pronouns are a form of the I. My would be a possessive pronoun. We, ours, you, your, he, his, him. All these are all forms of pronouns. It is a neuter gender pronoun. She is a feminine gender. He is a masculine gender. They can be either one. It depends. You'd have to look at the text. You can be either masculine or feminine. We or ours can be masculine or feminine. And I can be masculine or feminine. The only one of the pronouns that's going to be neuter is it. Well, you could have they in the sense of, well, there were 10 houses that needed to be torn down. Well, you could use they in that sense, but however you can use the neuter gender. It is always neuter gender. It. The table, it needs refinishing. The piano needs tuning. That's neuter gender.
They is always a person.
Yeah.
It is always a thing.
Yeah. This is always a thing. Thank you. Thing. So whenever the Bible says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for it, that is a bad translation. What do you mean it's a bad translation? I mean it's a bad translation. I don't care how many Greek scholars were in that room, those 47 scholars that translated the King James Bible. It is wrong. The Bible says, husbands, love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. That's what it says. That's what they said. Well, God's atonement is limited to his wife. Ephesians 5:25 says so. 5:25 says he only died for his wife, the church. If Jesus was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world, I keep saying that. Look over here in Revelation. Go to Revelation. Let's just do a little proving here. Look at Revelation, the 13th chapter. Revelation. Look here in verse 8. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship this beast whose names are not, only the only ones that will worship the beast, the world system, the ones whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If Christ was slain, he was slain in the mind of the Father, wasn't he?
Yes.
And look over here in chapter 17. Now, I don't know what people do with these verses. It just doesn't make any sense what they say. Look at verse 8 of chapter 17 of Revelation. The beast that thou sawest was and is not. Now, I've got a lot to say on that, but I'm not preaching on Revelation tonight, so let's just keep reading. And shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition, and they that dwell on the earth shall wonder whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world. That is saying there's certain men whose names were written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, and that's all of us who are the elect of God. So our names are written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, and Jesus is the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Do you think he was slain in general for anybody that wants to? When you die for somebody else or in their place, when you die for somebody else, he didn't say, whoever wants me to be die for them before the world began, I'll be your Savior if you just want it or if you just want to be in heaven. That's not the way he died. He died for a particular people, his wife, the church. This is a part of what's called Tulip. T-U-L-I-P. When you write that down, people will call you a Calvinist. I'm not a Calvinist. I believe Paul's writings. T means total depravity. this was created so people could understand predestination. And, well, is all men totally depraved? Well, yes, they are totally depraved. The Bible says there's none good, not one. There's none that understandeth. There's none that seeketh after God. Every man at his best state is altogether vanity. All men drink iniquity like water. Therefore, there's no good in a man. So depravity means you're completely with no good in you. Well, the U stands for unconditional, unconditional election. Now, when you're elected, you don't have anything to do with that. You don't, as a person, the mayor is not elected because he elects himself. The president is not elected because he elects himself. Let me read the word elect. To pick or choose. Now, Jesus said to the apostles, you have not chosen me, I've chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth much fruit. To pick or to choose, chosen, to give preference to. Of course, the Greek word elect is eklektos. It means to favor. People say, God doesn't favor one person above the other. Well, he certainly does. He favors his elect family. People say, God just leaves it up to us. He doesn't leave anything up to us. If he left it up to us, nobody's going to heaven, would they? Elected, but not yet installed in office, usually used in combination. And then it's number three in this. It's got, listen to this. This is out of Webster's Dictionary, under elect, chosen by God for salvation and eternal life. Now, I like that in Webster's. Thank you, Mr. Webster. To select for some office by voting, to choose, theologically, to choose for eternal salvation, only in the passive. Passive means we are passive, God is doing the acting. With God as the implied subject doing the acting, not us. Even Mr. Webster knows the truth about it. To make a choice, persons belonging to a special privileged group. The Bible says, from this word eklektos, we get the word ek, lego, my. Ek in Lego. Look at that over here in, you set this down. So elect means it's not something you do, it's somebody does. You are passive in the election process. Look over here and let me give you a couple of these. Eklegomai is a form, it's a derivative of elect. This means to favor, elect means to favor. Has God favored us? Well, I guess he has. It's just crazy to me. I'll finish this up right here in a minute. But look over here in Ephesians 1 and 4. Now, when you find these words, you're going to find, anytime you find eklegomai, it's a form of eklektos, election. Ek means out or from the beginning, and lego is the verbal form of logos. And logos is the word word. So God has worded us from the beginning, or from time immemorial. Look here in Ephesians 1. Ephesians 1. And verse 4, it's a reference back to verse 3. Let's read 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Now, he's blessed us. Now, he hadn't blessed everybody. If you look back in verse 1, look it back in verse 1. And Paul, many times, will introduce a book by saying these words. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God. He didn't say, I'm an apostle by my own will. When God struck him down on the road to Damascus in Acts the 9th chapter, was this all the will of Paul? Paul was going up to Damascus. He was on his way up here to Syria from Israel on a mission for the Sanhedrin to get some Christians up there and kill them. God strikes him down on the road. God strikes him down. Paul says, who art thou, Lord? And Paul was a killer of Christians. And Paul did not accept Christ. He did not pray a prayer. And God struck him down. And that's when God called him out of being the murderer that he was, to being the sinner that he was. It was all the will of God. Paul didn't accept anything. God didn't say, Paul, Paul, why persecutest thou me? Would you like to accept me as your personal Savior? Struck him down, and Paul said, who art thou, Lord? And God changed his life from then on. Paul was born again that day. I can't explain that other than to say I believe it because that's what happens. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ who has blessed us. The us is those people. Now notice what he says. I said this morning, notice everything that's said in the text. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God. There's sovereignty there, isn't it? Then he says, here is who I'm writing to the saints. Saints is the word hagios. It's the same word as holy. We are already saints. You don't have to be a Roman Catholic and be canonized into the Roman Catholic Church to be a saint. We are already saints. Saint comes from the word, this word saint, hagios, same word as holy, comes from the word hagiazo, means to sanctify. Hagiazo is also the word hallowed, so we are already saints. Paul said, I am, notice real close. He said, I'm only writing to saints. This book that I'm writing, this epistle is not to vessels of wrath fitted to destruction who have no hope. I'm only writing to the saints in Ephesus. So he says, to the saints, we're at Ephesus, and to the faithful that are in Christ Jesus at Ephesus. I'm only writing to the faithful and to the saints. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed, and notice the little, that little personal pronoun, us. He's blessed us. That's a form of we. Us. That's a pronoun. These are your basic pronouns right there. I learned that. I, we, you, he, she, it, and they. I learned that. Somewhere in the eighth grade, I think. But that's all the pronouns and everything else. A pronoun takes the place of a noun. A noun is a person, place, or thing. A person would be masculine or feminine. A place or a thing would be an it. It would be an it. So it's a person, place, or thing. Jim went to the store. He bought some bread. Well, of course, he is a pronoun, takes the place of Jim. Rather than saying Jim bought some bread, you just say he. And always the pronoun has to carry the same gender as the noun it modifies. So you can't say Jim went to the store, she bought some bread, or it bought some bread. You can't do that over here either with husbands love your wives as Christ loved the church and gave himself for her. You can't call a church an it. Like I've said before, call your wife an it and you're going to be in trouble. My wife's in the kitchen. It's cooking dinner. Well, she hears that. She's going to hit you in the head with a pan from in there. it's amazing to me how the translators would do this just to get by with it. Now, eklegomai, look here in verse 4. Now, he's blessed us in heavenly places. Now, he has covered us with heavenly things. Ep Oranos. E-P-O-U-R-A-N-I-O-S. E-P-O-U-R. I'm missing the spelling here. E-P-O-U-R-A-N-I-O-S. A-N-I-O-S. Now, the word O-U-R-A-N-O-U-S, that is the word heavens. Heavens. Now, remember, heavens was the judging, the ruling class. This is kind of amazing if you stop and think about it. The heavens was the ruling class. When the Bible says in the 65th chapter of Isaiah that there's going to be new heavens and new earth, and the heavens was the ruling class, and Israel was called the heavens, Israel. Well, now he's talking to a Gentile church, and he says they're spiritual Israel, so they are the heavens. When he says he's blessed us in heavenly places, ep uranios comes from the word epi and uranos. He has covered us with the heavens or with the ruling class. That's the same thing as saying we are spiritual Israel. New heavens and new earth, that's quoted over there in Isaiah 65 first, and then we see new heavens and new earth there in Revelation 21, those first couple of verses there. Well, new heavens doesn't mean a new heaven coming down from heaven. Coming out of heaven is talking about the new birth. So he says he's blessed us in heavenly places. Notice how much meaning there is in one little word. In heavenly places. Now, here is how he's done it. According as he hath chosen us, he's chosen us to be the heavens, and he's chosen us, and that word chosen is a form of elect. It's a form of elect, eklektos. It is the word eklegomai. That's the word right there. When you go into your... Let me show you something. Everybody needs a word study concordance. If you don't have, it's better to have one of these. If you can't get one of these, you'll have to find it on Amazon somewhere. And if you're looking up this word, eklegomai, you look up the word chosen, you go into your concordance, you look up the word chosen, and what you do, you'll find it number 1586 in the concordance. So you go in here, go to 1586, and you'll see here, and here's the list of every time the word eklegomai is used. Eklegomai, and it's not always the word chosen. Eklegomai is in the New Testament 21 times. It says 21 right there. It's 21 times in here. And you go down here to Ephesians 1 and 4. It is the word hath chosen. He hath chosen us in him before the foundation of the world. Now, if you look in your concordance, your word study concordance, it will tell you, if you look down here at eklektos, which is just below it, that's the word elect, and it'll have 1588, and then over here to the right, it's got 1586. That 1586 means that 1588 is a form of 1586. There's 1586, that's the word chosen. So elect is a form of eklegomai. Now, let me give you eklegomai. Eklegomai comes from ek and legomai. Eklegomai means to select or make a choice, to choose out. It means a systematic arrangement. It means something according to a system. According to a system, it means a set. Lego means a set discourse. A discourse is a speech or something in writing that is upon a subject at length or extent. A discourse is a communication of ideas or information, talking at a long formal treatment, and that would be the Word of God. This is God's discourse. If a man stands in front of an audience and he gives a discourse, he is giving a speech on some long, lengthy subject with some system to it. If a guy gets up and gives a speech on electronics, he stays within the borders of electrical engineering or electronics language, and he uses all that language. That would be a discourse. I'm giving a discourse up here every time I stand up here and teach the Bible. So it means a long formal treatment of writing in a speech or in a writing, the ability to reason rationally. So that's what an eklegomai is. And God has chosen us. He has elected us. That's what election is. And he says he has chosen us in him. Before the foundation of the world, we were chosen to be holy. To be holy and without blame. Holy. Now, we've been talking about, and without blame, we've been talking about how we still have that old man alive in us. We've got an inner man and an outer man that wants to, the outer man tries to hang on. When you come to the knowledge of Christ, sometimes that outer man still wants to smoke a little. Sometimes he wants to cuss a little. Sometimes he wants to get angry a little, be jealous a little, and to be and get involved in what was called the orgē, and that is O-R-G-A-T-A, and that's feminine gender, and that's the wrath of revenge, or when you're covetous and somebody's stolen something, you beat you out of something, you're wanting to get vengeance, and God says vengeance is mine. That's a part of that outer man that has to die off, and it takes a lot of trials and persecution to cause us to stop our anger. I keep saying this. I have had to learn this as I grew older. We don't have any business getting angry at any time other than false teachers, but we don't get angry and go to sleep with that at night. Be angry and sin not. And let not the sun go down upon your wrath. We're not supposed to be getting furious and angry with the world. We get angry at false teachers. Now, this word eklegomai is a form of elect. Let me give you a couple other verses on eklegomai. Look over here in John 6. John 6. Now, Jesus is having a discourse with his apostles. We just talked about a discourse. And he's speaking to them, and he's instructing them. In John 6, you will notice that he's speaking to them, and every time you find red letters in your Bible, that's Jesus talking to you. Now, he's got red letters all through 53 down through 58. That's where he's talking about, I'm the bread of life, except ye eat my flesh and drink my blood, and the bread is my flesh, and my flesh is meat indeed, and indeed, aletheis means of truth. So eat of the flesh of Christ means to eat of truth. And then he goes on down here in verse 61. Well, let's read a little before that. Verse 59, these things said he in the synagogue, and he taught in Capernaum. Now, Capernaum was on the northern border of the Sea of Galilee. Jesus adopted Capernaum as his hometown. He was up here in Nazareth. Nazareth is in the land of Zebulun, and he moved up here on the northern border of the Sea of Galilee to Capernaum and adopted that for his home. And if you'll remember, Peter and James and John were fishermen on this Sea of Galilee, and that's where he starts his ministry. He's preaching most of his life in northern Israel, not in southern Judah. Every time he gets down to southern Judah, the only reason he comes to Judah is to come to one of the feast days, Passover, Pentecost, or the Feast of Ingathering, which was coupled with the Day of Atonement. And every time he'd get down there, he'd do something, he'd upset the Pharisees, he'd heal on the Sabbath, and he'd take off and go back into northern Israel because they wouldn't go up there. They said that was filthy and unclean up there. Now look here in verse, where was I? 59. These things said he in synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. That's on the northern border of Galilee. Many, therefore, of the disciples, when they had heard this, said, this is a hard saying. Who can hear it? Who can eat flesh and drink blood? And when Jesus knew in himself that his disciples murmured at it, he said unto them, does this offend you? I'm saying, except you eat my flesh and drink my blood. Now, you know that is an old ancient saying that meant partaking of slaughter. And here I am, a peaceful teacher, and you're wondering, how in the world are we going to be slaughtered? You have to remember, the apostles were very young men. They could not possibly have been the old men as they're depicted in pictures when Jesus called them. They're going to live up into nearly the end of the first century. John is one of his apostles. John's going to write the book of Revelation somewhere around 96 A.D., Well, this has to be somewhere around 30 A.D. So John can't be very old at that time because 96 A.D. when he writes Revelation is 66 years later. You got to think about that. That's why it's good to look up Revelation in your McClintock and Strong and see when it is written. And that was John the Beloved that wrote it. So he says, does this offend you? What and if you see the Son of Man ascend up where he was before? It is the Spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. Now these people that want to say their flesh can do good things, the Spirit makes a man alive. This is a real good verse when people say, they talk about being slain in the Spirit. The Spirit doesn't kill anybody. The Spirit, Z-O-O-P-O-I-E-O, quickens, makes alive. The Spirit don't slay anybody. And then he says, the words that I speak unto you, when I say eat my flesh and drink my blood, they're spiritual and they're life. They're not literal. But there are some of you that believe not. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not and who should betray him. Oh, if he knew, why did he let it go happen? Because he had a program. Judas was picked by Jesus before the foundation of the world. He had to betray Christ and turn him over to the hands of sinners so they could crucify him so he could die for his wife. That was all planned by God. Jesus said, no man takes my life from me. I lay my life down. Nobody killed Jesus without his permission. Not only his permission, but his plan and program. For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not and who should betray him. And he said, therefore said I unto you, that no man can come unto me except it were given to him of my Father. It has to be put in your heart to come to Christ. And you don't do that. It has nothing to do with your will. From that time, many of the disciples went back and walked no more with him. They didn't like predestination. So they quit. They say, we're quitting. We don't like this kind of a Jesus. Then said Jesus unto the 12, Will you also go away? Then Simon Peter answered, Lord, to whom shall we go? You're the one that has the words of eternal life. Sometimes we want to go away, but we say, where shall we go? The only way to go is straight ahead, isn't it? And we believe and are sure that thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered them, Have not I chosen you 12? Chosen is that word eklegomai. It's a form of elect. He's saying, I've elected all 12 of you, and one of you is a devil. I elected an evil man to betray me so I can die for my wife. Do you think Jesus knew what he was doing? Was there any question about what he was doing? No. He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. Now, look over here. So, chosen there, have I chosen you 12? That's the word eklegomai. Now, let's go over here to John 15. John 15. All right. Look here in John 15. And look here in verse. Jesus, now if you'll notice, if you got a red letter Bible, that means these are Jesus' words. This is the last discourse of Jesus before he dies. If you'll notice, in John 13 is the last Passover. From John 13, these are the last words of Jesus to his apostle. And he's talking to him. You notice a bunch of red letters. That's Jesus talking in chapter 13. And then in chapter 14, most of that is Jesus' words, except for verse 5, verse 8, verse 22. And then when you get to 15, everything that is said in 15 is Jesus' direct words to his apostles. Now, this is Jesus talking. He says, let's start here in verse 14. You are my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. Now, being a friend of Jesus is very conditional, isn't it? You have to do what he says to be his friend. Now the word friend, now when you think where other words are friend, where friend is mentioned. Philia. Notice what he says. You're my friends if you do the things I say. When you see something like that, think. Walk in the commandments of God, right? Walk in commandments. He said, if you walk in my commandments, 2 John 6, this is love, this is agape, that we walk after his commandments. So think, if you see anything that he says, walking in my commandments to do the things that I say or do whatsoever I command you, if you see anything that says that, there, it's saying the same thing. Walk in his commandments, do whatever I command you. He says, you are my friends, Philia. I'm fond of you. I have an affection for you. Now, this is going to apply to us. I have an affection. And people say, well, we've got to be friends with everybody. You've got to be friends with your family. No, you know, don't. Your brother, your mother, your brothers and sisters are those who do the will of the Father. Because Jesus said that was his mother and brothers and sisters. And we're predestined to be like Christ. those who do the will of the Father is our family. So he says, I have an affection for you and your friends only if you keep my commandments. This also applies to us. Our friends are those who walk in the commandments of God when we're walking in his commandments, right? So that's like Jesus. So he says here, I'm affectionate to you. And always think, is there someplace else he mentions friends that's very significant?
James 4:4.
He said, friends with the world are enemies of God. Know you not that friendship with the world is enmity, ekthra, is hostile to God, and whosoever be a friend of the world is the enemy of God? So when you're seeing friend one place, think of friends on the opposite end of things. James 4:4 says, if you're friends with the world, so therefore we can't be friends with the world, can we? But does that mean to mistreat people? No. We are to be Christ-like, be cordial to people. I'm very cordial to every waitress or waiter in a restaurant that waits on me. I'm very cordial. I don't jump their case and chew them out and say, you're probably going to hell if you celebrate Christmas. Christmas is pagan. Don't you know that? I'll tell some young waitress, I'll say, hey, let me give you something before you leave. This is a DVD. I'm a Bible teacher. And I'll tell you some things about history and about Christmas and about God doesn't love everybody. Sometimes I'll just say it like that. And they'll go, okay, I'll watch this. I say, okay. I've given thousands of them away in the Hendersonville area. I've never had one phone call. My job is not to get people to believe. My job is to get the truth to them, and that's all. The Holy Spirit will do the work he wants to do. I got a call from a fellow yesterday. He said, I got a hold of one of your DVDs. And he said, man, I love what you're saying. I've been wondering where somebody was. I said, where did you get it? He said, a guy up here in Ohio gave it to me. I said, who was that? He said, Anthony Maddox. I said, Anthony gave you a... He said, yeah. He said, man, I love this. He said, I've got to come down and see you. You don't ever know when you're going to give a DVD to somebody and they're going to watch it. And it just rung a bell down in this guy's heart. And he's going to come down and see us. So think of, you're my friends if you walk after my commandments, if you do the things that I say, but if you're friends with the world, you're my enemy. That's what James says. So let's keep reading here. You're my friends if you do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth. But I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. You have not chosen me, eklegomai. That's a form of elect. You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you. The word ordained, it's a very broad word. It's the word tithame. You find tithame in a lot of words. It's the same word. It's the same word when Jesus said, I lay down my life for my friends. Nobody takes my life from me. When they took Jesus, when the Romans took him and they were scourging him, taking him to a cross, Jesus said, I'm the one that's in charge here. You're not. He was dying for his wife, the church. Not it, but her. So he says, I've ordained you, and that word tithame can also mean to ordain. It has a very broad spectrum. You have not chosen me, but I've chosen you and ordained you. I didn't just choose you for no reason. Every time you find elect, predestinate, called, we were called unto righteousness. That ye should go and bring forth fruit. Now, what is he talking about? Apples and oranges and bananas? No. He's talking about Ephesians 5:22, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, etc. And that your fruit should remain, it should continue. That whatsoever you shall ask, boy, now, of the Father in my name, he may give it you. But of course, ask is the word A-I-T-E-O, and that's conditional in 1 John 3:22. We receive the things that we ask if we keep his commandments, tereo, guard them from loss. They're written in our hearts and we say they are true, whether you like it or not, whether I like it or not, they're true. And that's that, he says, whatsoever you ask, and you have to ask, we receive the things that we ask if we keep his commandments and do the things that are pleasing. And what pleases God is death to self. We've said that. Romans 12:1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And the word acceptable is the same base word as pleasing in 1 John 3:22. It's the same base word. So what's pleasing to God is death to self. Well, if you're dying to self, you never ask for self, do you? He's not talking about asking for a car. That's ridiculous. These things I command you, that you love one another. And then he says some of my favorite words here in verse 18. If the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you, and they will hate you, he says. If you were of the world would love you. If you wonder why your family don't like what you're saying about predestination and Christmas is pagan and daily cross and death to self, and you tell them they cannot accept Christ, you tell them they cannot pray a sinner's prayer for salvation, if you want to know why they hate you, this is why right here. When the Bible says that you have to be hated here in these verses, you have to be persecuted, they're not going to persecute you for accepting Christ as your personal Savior, are they? They're not going to hate you for celebrating Christmas with a bunch of heathens. Nobody's going to hate you for that. They're going to hate you when you say Christmas is Roman Catholicism, it's pagan. When you say you have to take your cross and die daily. When you say you have to suffer for righteousness' sake. When you say all that will of God in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. When you say no man should be moved by these afflictions, knowing that you are appointed to be afflicted. We must through much tribulation into the kingdom of God. That'll make people angry. Say, so you can't go to heaven with a nice walk down an aisle up here at the Baptist church or at the Church of Christ. You're not going that way. You have to be a new creature. You have to be somebody you did not used to be. You have to become somebody else. Mary said that to me one night after I preached. She said, we were riding home. She said, I realized something tonight. It really hit home with me. She said, I have to become somebody that the old me wouldn't recognize, don't I? I said, that's right. And she said, I'm beginning to see. I'm changing. I'm becoming somebody else. That's the new creature that we have to become. We got to get rid of all of that anger and that rage and that strife and that contention. That has to go. We're new people, aren't we? He says, if you were of the world would love you. But you're my friends. But because you're not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. It's just amazing to me that people don't understand this. And he says, I have chosen you out of the world. Have chosen is the word eklegomai. I have elected you out of the world. Remember the word that I said unto you? The servant is not greater than his Lord. You're no better than I. If I'm going to have to die and be hated, so are you. That's what he's saying right here. If they have persecuted me, they will persecute you. He is saying, you're not going to go to heaven without being persecuted. He's saying the same thing he says over in John 14. He's saying, in Luke 14, he says you have to bear your cross. if you don't, Luke 14:27, he that beareth not his cross and followeth after me cannot be my disciple. You can't be a follower of Christ without a daily cross. Men are going to condemn you to a cross because they don't like this message. Do you know that's the only struggle we have? We're going to be talking about a world. The mouth is what gets you in trouble with the world, because what's in our heart is going to come out of our mouth. It just is. What a man believes in his heart always comes out of his mouth. Of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. What's in a man's heart, if self is in his heart and money and things and stuff, that's what he's going to talk about. If Christ is in a person's heart, he's going to talk about Christ. I cannot go home to my family and sit and talk about everybody's vacation and where they went on vacations and talk about their new car or how they're going to fix this or buy that, or are they going to paint the house, or and have all these conversations. And all the time I'm sitting there, I know that if I mention daily cross or self-denial or death to self, everybody's going to go, oh, they're going to look at me. I hope Jimmy doesn't start talking about that. Well, I am. I'm not going to sit without, as much as I love this book, you think I can sit and all day long and not talk about it? Family, I care about you. But I'm not the same man I used to be. God has dealt with my heart to live 24 hours a day in this Word. This is all I think about around the clock. I wake up thinking about it. I walk into a store. I walk into the post office. I walk into the bank. And I pray a little short prayer. Lord, help me if I haven't said the right thing to somebody to witness to them in here so it'll have some effect. Lord, just help me. I have those little short prayers all day long. I don't go into a store without saying, Lord, help me to say the right thing. I've talked to all these people in here, and I don't want to just to be abusive and to be belligerent and sharp and cutting, but Lord, help me just to say something that I need to say. I have little quick prayers like that through the day. This is my life. This is everything to me. I want this Word and I want this truth more than I want anything in the world. Expect me to quit talking about it, to come visit you? Ain't going to happen. If they have persecuted me, they will persecute you. Let me ask you a question. Did they persecute Jesus? Well, he preached and they killed him for his words. You read that 23rd chapter of Matthew, and he's calling the Pharisees children of hell, generation of snakes. You're whited sepulchers. You're full of dead men's bones. Whew, that was enough to... They said, we're going to kill you. This is the last straw. And they did exactly that. That's an idiom, last straw, isn't it? If they have kept my sayings, they will keep yours also. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake. Jesus is saying, you're going to be persecuted and you're going to be hated. I heard an ignorant preacher in this town say one time, we can't suffer persecution in America because... we're a Christian nation. You are a dumbbell, mister, and you know who you are. I hope God's dealt with your heart, but I don't think he has. What idiocy. We can't suffer persecution in America and tribulation because we're a Christian nation. If this is a Christian nation, Lord, please don't let me go to heaven and spend eternity with these people. All these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me. When you start being persecuted by people because you say Christmas is pagan, Easter's pagan, God doesn't love everybody, whoever's persecuting you for it, if it's your mother, if it's your brothers and sisters, your blood brothers and sisters, if it's your boss, the reason they're doing this is because they do not know God. That's what he said, didn't he? But now he says, if I had not come and spoken unto them, They had not had sin. If I hadn't come into the world, and my word has been eternal from the foundation of the world, then they wouldn't have any sin, because you only have sin because of my words when I say the sin is the transgression of the law. If I hadn't come, I wouldn't have had this law. He's saying, when I gave the law to Moses, and that was written down in the annals of God's time before the foundation of the world, then you wouldn't have any sin. But now, notice what he says, but now they have nothing to cover up their sin with. Men that hate us cannot cover their sin. If I had not done among them the works which none other man did, they had not had sin. He said, I showed them who I was with my works, with my miracles. And now they have both seen and hated both me and my Father. And notice he said right before this, if they hated me, they'll hate you. And right here he's saying, they hate me and my Father, because they hate his words. But this cometh to pass, that the word might be fulfilled, that it is written in their law in Psalm 69:4, they hated me without a cause. They didn't have any reason to hate me. Had no cause. And the Bible says that many times in the Old Testament. But when the Comforter is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, this Spirit of truth, which will be in us, will testify of me. He won't speak of himself. The Holy Spirit won't say, I got the Holy Ghost. Do you have the Holy Ghost? A man that has the Holy Spirit will speak of Christ. Won't be like the Pentecostal. I got the Holy Ghost. Do you have it? Ye also shall bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. You have been mine from the beginning. I did the choosing, you didn't. Now, let me finish this up here, and then I'll get back to this. Unconditional election. Did we do anything to be elected by God?
No.
Not one thing. God just simply created all the world, and he had all these people out here in the world. He had this big flock of human beings. And he said, these right here are my elect sheep. And the rest of these are the many goats. And a goat never becomes a sheep. A sheep never is a goat. And when the shepherd leads these sheep out into pasture, and one of them goes off here and gets lost, all lost sheep belong to a shepherd. Sheep have to have a shepherd. Goats don't need shepherds. They're wild by nature. They climb up on high mountains, and on that one dam over in Italy, these ibex goats climb up there, and it's a pitch about like that, and they can walk all over that dam. And the little baby goats, ibex goats, will run down that and run up something about that steep. It's the craziest thing I've ever seen. It came on the TV, and I recorded on my DVD. I've got it on my DVD, and that's the craziest thing I've ever seen. Never seen nothing like it. And they'll climb 200 feet in the air, and the pitch will be about like it'd be little bitty rocks sticking out. And they say they've got their feet are like climbing boots, and they can grip that rock and they can just run up and down. And a little bitty tiny ibex goat be running all around its mother, running up and down that thing. That shows you how wild goats are, and they do not need a shepherd. And the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. And he says, all that the Father giveth me shall come to me. Every one of the sheep are going to come. And he's going to save every lost sheep. Now, preachers will preach, if you're lost tonight and you want to get saved, if you're lost, you're going to go to hell as a lost sheep. No, you're not. You're not going to go to hell as a lost sheep. No sheep are lost. It's not the Father's will that one of these little ones, one of these little sheep should perish. the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, where some men count slackness, but he's long-suffering toward us, not willing that any of us should perish. That's what the original text says. He's not willing that any of the flock should perish, but all these goats are vessels of wrath, fitted to destruction. These are natural brute beasts made to be taken and destroyed. These are men before of old, ordained to this condemnation. And we are God's elect. And our election is not just, I've elected you to be in heaven. That's not what it's about. If you look, remember what we said here in John 15. He said, you are my friends. Do you know that the shepherd over in the Old Testament was called a friend of the sheep? That's what he was called. He was a friend of the sheep. He laid down with them. He slept with them. He went out into the woods with them. He went out on the plain. He was always there. He had his sling. He had his rod. And when David was shepherding the sheep, he said, I killed a bear with this rod, and I killed a lion with this rod, and I'll lay my life down for my sheep. And anybody tries to get my sheep, I'll kill you trying to get to my sheep. And the shepherd literally sacrificed his life for the flock. And he was called a friend of the sheep. He lived with them around the clock. He loved them. And he knew his sheep by name. I love Mr. Keller's book, Shepherds Look at the 23rd Psalm. He said the shepherd was so familiar with his flock. You could put a blindfold on the shepherd, and you could bring his sheep at night by him. And he could have a blindfold on at midnight, and he could touch each one of those sheep, and he knew them by name, by touch. Whew. That's knowing the sheep, isn't it? He said, I know my sheep, I am known of mine. They belong to me. We were given to Christ before the world began. And the Pharisees said, how long are you going to make us to doubt? If thou be the Christ, tell us plainly. He said, you will not believe because you're not of my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. They know me, and they follow me. And I give my sheep eternal life, and I do not give goats eternal life. You don't belong to me. Get away from me, Pharisees. You're goats. And boy, they said, we hate you. We'll kill you one day. And they did. All that he gives me shall come to me. All of God's sheep are going to come. And you can say, I don't know if I'm a sheep. Well, you don't have to worry about it. If you belong to him, he'll convict your heart, and somewhere along the way, you'll start coming to him. And if you don't ever come to him, you don't belong to him, just go out and party and go to hell, okay? God's sheep will come. Not might come. All that the Father giveth shall come. And if you don't, and Jesus tells the Pharisees over there in John 8, in John 8, he says, the reason you don't come, this is one of my favorite verses. In verse 47, John 8, he that is of God heareth God's words. Ye therefore hear them not, because you're not of God. You don't belong to God. Get away, Pharisees, you're going to hell. And that's the majority, that's all the goats, and that's the majority of the world. But he's elected us to obey him as sheep. Sheep are supposed to obey the shepherd, but a lot of times they don't. They'll wander off and get on their back and find some easy place to be cast, and their legs will go straight up in the air, and they can't get on their feet, and they're like a turtle. And the shepherd will always get there on time before the wolf gets there. And he'll say, little one, why do you wander off from the flock? Don't you know I love you? And he has to break our hearts to make us realize that. Now, let me finish this up here. Well, let me show you what we're elected to. Look over here in 1 Peter. We're talking about election. That's picking someone. He said, you didn't elect me, I elected you. I've chosen you. Look here in 1 Peter. We've started in this and we haven't finished it. 1 Peter. And people who worry about whether they're elect or not, let me tell you something about goats. Goats never wonder if they are sheep. They never do worry about being sheep. They don't have any conviction. They have no inner man. They don't believe God. Why would shepherds need a goat when they don't need anybody leading them? They can climb up and down walls and climb up and down mountains. And some of these goats in these high mountains, they'll be a straight drop, 1,000 feet. And they're as sure-footed as if they were on level ground. You don't ever hear of a goat being falling off of a cliff or off of a mountain. They're naturally sure-footed. They need no shepherd. Now, look here in 1 Peter 1. When he eklegomized us, he chooses us to go and bring forth fruit. He predestined us to be holy and predestined us to conform to the image or the likeness of Jesus. He's chosen us in him before the foundation of the world that we should be holy and without blame. All of this is to accountability and responsibility. People say, you people that believe in predestination, you believe you can live the way you want. We don't believe that, you ignoramus. We believe we have to live holy and godly. I believe in holy, godly, righteous living. That's what God has called us to, hasn't he? I believe in not cussing, not drinking, not smoking, not living wild, not running around with people that do. Instead of, gosh, what are you, an isolationist? Well, Christ was an isolationist. Yeah, I'm an isolationist. I isolate myself from worldly people. I used to not do that, and it affected me terribly. How much time do I have, Mike?
26.
Now look here. Peter's talking to strangers scattered to Pontus and Galatia and Cappadocia, Asia and Bithynia. He's talking to believing Gentiles. He said, you are elect. According... You can take prepositional phrases and leave them out of a sentence and you still have the main structure of the sentence. So let's leave this phrase out. According to the foreknowledge of God the Father through sanctification of the Spirit. The body of the sentence is elect unto obedience and the sprinkling of blood. That's the basic sentence. Elect unto obedience and sprinkling. It tells, when you leave out those phrases, according to the foreknowledge of God, through, these are conjunction, they're acting as prepositions here, according and through. And you can leave out those phrases to get the basic sentence. It is certainly according to the foreknowledge of God, the prognosis of God, knowing beforehand, and through sanctification of the Spirit. And here's what we elected unto. Unto obedience and a blood baptism. A blood baptism was a martyrdom. So you're elected to obey God, and when you do, he's washed us from our sins in his own blood, and a blood baptism was a martyrdom or a death. You're elected to obey God, preach the truth, tell people the truth that's in your heart, and to die for it. Not a literal cross in America today. It might be in the future, but it'll be a figurative cross men will nail us to. So we're elected to die daily. Sprinkling of blood of Jesus Christ, grace be unto you and great peace from God. Peace be multiplied. Of course, sprinkling of blood is the true meaning of baptism. Baptize, baptizo, and bapto. Bapto, baptism was originally an infinitive. An infinitive is a noun with verbal character. If I said to be baptized, to be washed, to be turned, to be in our language is a form of an infinitive, to be. It means this is what's going to happen to you from an outer source. The fluid will come from an outer source in an infinitive. It will be a washing coming from a source, and the source, in the case of baptism, is God. And baptizo means to cover. Bapto means to stain with a dye. So being an infinitive, it has the same meaning as a sprinkling of blood. Sprinkle means it has to come from an outer source, and the object is sprinkled, and our hearts are sprinkled with the blood of Christ, there in Hebrews 10:22. So, when it says, elect unto obedience and the sprinkling of blood, obeying God makes him our friend, and sprinkling of blood is death to self. They go together, because when we obey God, we preach the truth, we talk truth that's in our hearts, and men crucify us for it, and that's a blood baptism. Now, let me get the rest of this. Is our election something we did? No. Are we totally depraved? Yes. And that L, this tulip thing, is the L stands for limited atonement. Was Christ's blood sufficient for all the human race? Well, it was sufficient, but he did not apply it to the goats. Those people are dying for their own sin in hell. Jesus did not die in the place of somebody in hell. Death means separation. Thanatos, T-H-A-N-A-T-O-S, means separation. It does not mean to be annihilated. The man in hell is dying or being separated from God for his own sin. The rich man died and in hell he lifted up his eyes being in torment. There in the 16th chapter of Luke, he said, Father Abraham, send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. I'm tormented in this flame. He said, Son, remember thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things and Lazarus evil things. Now he's confident thou art tormented. Besides this, there's a great gulf fixed. So those that are here can't come there, and those that are there will never come here. Don't you believe these people say, I died and went to hell, and then I went to heaven. No, you didn't. It's your imagination. And that word gulf is the word chasma, C-H-A-S-M-A. It means a separation. It's a synonym for death. It's a synonym for thanatos. So the man in hell is being separated from God for his own sin. Jesus did not die for the people in hell. If he did, then God is requiring a double payment for sin, isn't he? He didn't die for them. He died for his wife, the church. Is God's atonement limited? Is it sufficient if God had wanted to apply it to all mankind? Yeah, if he wanted to. When people say, they get on TV and say, Jesus died for you. And I like what Dave says. How do you know that? You can't say that about me. You don't know who I am and don't know what I am. You don't know if I'm a believer or not, or if I'm a sheep or a goat. They get on there, Jesus died for everyone, and won't you come and accept him? Baloney! God will convict the hearts of his elect. Irresistible grace. T-U-L-I-P, irresistible grace. Can you resist the grace of God? How can you resist grace when it's the word charis and it means unmerited favor? It has the basic same meaning as elect. He has grace upon us. Grace, by definition, means something you cannot merit by anything you do. So is his grace irresistible? Certainly it is. When he has grace upon us, In order to have grace, there has to be something in opposition to that. You can't have grace on somebody if there's no such thing as wrath. And then perseverance of the saints. Perseverance. Are we going to persevere? The Bible says we are. He that hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. They that endure to the end, the same shall be saved. Over there in Matthew 24. Hupo meno. Are we going to endure? Yes, because Philippians 1:6 says, he begins it and he ends it. That has the same meaning as the word saved. And hupomone is the word patient. And the trying of your faith works patience. So all the fire is going to cause us to endure to the end because he's going to make us new creatures. And we're going to be different than we've ever been. If you haven't changed, every one of us are changing, aren't we? I'm changing all the time. I'm wanting to live. The older I get, the longer I live, the more I want to live for Christ. I didn't want to live for Christ when I was 35. I wanted to live for me and for Jesus, both of us. I wanted to be pursuing my career and God at the same time. It don't work that way. You pursue God and be not weary in well-doing. You'll reap a reward in due time if you don't relax. The word means to relax. If we faint not, means to relax. Just keep doing what you're supposed to do. Yes, but this thing is getting boring. It's getting long. I know that. You just keep doing it. If you get on a job and keep doing the job and keep working and keep doing a good job, eventually you get a promotion and you get a raise. It's the same thing in the world. Now, do we persevere? We certainly persevere. I don't preach Tulip all the time because people say, that's Calvinism. No, I believe in a man's totally depraved. I believe he has been elected by the will of God and his atonement is limited to his wife. It's sufficient for everybody, but he didn't die for everybody. He's the one that limited himself and his death to his wife. He said so. And we will persevere. Now, let me give you a couple of things on elect. When we're elected, we're chosen by God. Look over here, and I want you to notice what this gets us into. Go to 2 Peter. Now, after we are believers, he's telling us we have to increase our faith. Second, when people get angry at me for the hard words I preach, they're not my words, they're God's word. If I did what my flesh wanted to do, I would try to be friends with everybody and get along with everybody. But you can't, as a believer, you got something in your heart that comes out of your mouth. I can't run with the world. My family, I miss them. I miss my sister and my mother. And there's nothing I can do. I would like to be their friend. But in order to be my friend, you got to be interested in the commandments of God, Janice. Mama, you got to be interested in God's commandments. I'm not the same person that you used to know. I'd really have to introduce myself again to my family and say, I'm a new man. I'm not the man I used to be seeking. Like my sister said back when I was in the music world, she said, you remind me of that song, I'm always chasing rainbows. And I was always chasing. I'm not chasing no rainbow anymore. I'm living every minute of every day for the Lord. This is where God was calling me to when I was that frustrated young man seeking my flesh. He's calling me to this. This is what God had in mind all along. I'm not angry at my family. My father died. I didn't even know he died. One of the guys in the church said, I think your father's dead. I said, well, how do you know? He said, well, I heard your brother talking about his funeral on TV. Didn't know it. Didn't know my older brother that I was raised with. Me and Clyde were together all the time. Didn't know he died. He died on the day of our picnic, our annual picnic, 2 years ago. And I found that out by going online and trying to find him online. I found out he died, and they had his funeral. It's not that I want to be away from my family. I'm going to talk these truths every day for the rest of my life. I'm going to be standing up here preaching these truths till I die.
With no compromise.
And I'm not compromised with nobody. I'm not mad at anybody. I'm just not going to compromise. And if I can stand up here when I'm 88, like you, I'll be standing here preaching this truth.
Amen.
That's 12 years from now. If I can stand up here at 90, I'll be standing up here preaching these truths until I die. I hope when it comes time to die that at the end of the service I say amen and I fall dead. And I'll tell you right now, just take me out and stick me in a garbage can because I'm not going to be there. I'm going to be with the Lord. I look forward to going to be with Him. Now, look here in 2 Peter. I'm going to read a verse to you. Do I have any time, Mike?
Well,
I'm going to come back to this, but I'm going to read something here to you. Look here in verse 10. Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling, your kaleo, make sure you are the called of God. How do you do that? Make your calling and election sure. Make your calling kaleo. Of course, we are the ekklesia, which comes from ek and kaleo. Ekklesia is the word church. We are called out of this world to live righteously. So he says, make your calling and election. How can I really know that I'm a believer? How can I know I'm elect of God? Even whenever you're asking that question to yourself, I said it earlier, goats never do want to know if they're elect. If you're wanting to know that you're elect, you're like a little baby that's wanting the knowledge of an adult. Say, I want to grow up and know who I am. I want to know that I know God. That word sure, when you make your calling and election sure, you know you're being picked by God. Now, most people, when they see that word sure, I heard a preacher one time say, you got to be positive. No, that's not what that word is. The word is bibios. Bibios means to stabilize. When you stabilize something, you put a foundation under it, you prop it up. If you stabilize something, I used to be out on the road, and whenever we would have a flat tire or something and we were on a hill, would say, chalk the wheel there, stabilize the car, put something under there, find a rock and put it under so the car won't roll back. Stabilize it. When you stabilize your calling and election, right before that, he says there's seven things you have to add to your faith. A lot of people want to know, how do I really know that I'm a believer? Well, Paul said over in 2 Timothy, Paul has something to go with this, and he says, I'm an apostle, a preacher, and a teacher. Since I am an apostle and a preacher and a teacher, and I'm teaching these truths that we're teaching here, he said, I suffer for these things. Like Jesus said, he said in John 15, if I suffer, you have to suffer. Paul said, I'm suffering. And Paul at one time was a Pharisee killing Christians for a living. He was a Christian killer. And the apostles were scared to death when Barnabas brought him down to Jerusalem to introduce him to the apostles. He said, that man's a killer. Get him away from us. But he said, now I have a completely different vocation in life. I am preaching the things that I used to kill people for doing. Then he says, and I'm suffering for doing this, therefore I know whom I have believed. I know whom I believed. He didn't say, I gnosko whom I believe. People say, I know I'm saved. No, you mean gnosko. I have learned to walk down the aisle, and the preacher said, I'll be saved if I do that. That's not true. When Paul said, I know whom I believed, he said, I see. I've watched myself do the things that I used to persecute, and I've become a different man. I've become the man that I would have killed at one time. You got to become somebody different than the guy you used to be or the girl you used to be. You say, Jim, I'm not growing very fast. Well, the Bible says you can't grow fast because back there in 2 Peter, what stabilizes us is adding the seven things that he mentions. He says, besides all this, in verse 5, giving all diligence, add to your faith. Add, epikouragio, means to augment something to your faith. Your faith has to grow. Paul said, instead of fighting me, you'll come to a place, Corinth. Now, Corinth, he didn't have much good to say about Corinth ever. And he says, you're arguing, you don't like my presence, you don't like my words, you say they're weighty when I write a letter to you. And he said, you got nothing but complaints from me because I kept reprimanding you for being carnal, being contentious and full of division and strife, and your babies. He said, I've called you down. But he said there in 10 and 15 of 2 Corinthians, when your faith is increased, you'll quit calling me names and giving me a hard time, and you'll begin to extol the words that I'm preaching to you. You have to grow before you're going to lift up the preacher that says real hard words about David Cross, debt to self, self-denial. Without a David Cross, whenever you say to somebody, do you know that without a cross you can't be a disciple or a follower of Christ? That will bother people when you say, do you know what a David Cross is? Do you know where you can get a David Cross? People that call themselves Christians, when you ask them those questions, they don't have any idea what you're talking about. And that'll make them mad. You say, I'm not a Christian because I don't have a cross. That's right. You're not without a cross. Jesus said that. We didn't say that. So he says, add to your faith virtue, arete, maturity. This is part of make your calling and election sure or stabilizing. You're going to have to grow up spiritually. Add knowledge, gnosis. Knowledge comes out of the Word of God. Read your Bible. Read it, read it, read it, read it. And to knowledge, temperance, enkratia. We talked about that a couple of weeks ago. It means self-control. Enkratia. It means control yourself. Don't be out of control. You're out of control when you're trying to control other people and cause them to believe truth and getting mad at them and you're losing your temper. You're not supposed to be doing that. When you're trying to control other people, you're out of control and you're not temperate. Jim, I don't know how to live the way you talk. It took me a long time to learn how to live. Out in public, around people, around my family. I have learned so much in the last 10 years I can't even express to people. I said some real hard things in my mid-50s in this ministry to people, And I don't even treat people the way I taught them in my mid-50s. I've learned to be gentle, kind, tender-hearted, uncompromising, firm, bold. Boy, that's a hard mixture. You know it, how to be meek, tame, to be bold, blunt, yet not abusive, not abrasive, not just trying to be hard to get along with, to talk to people. But that takes maturity to learn that. I'll tell you what, when you start talking to somebody, be like Jesus. Was he plain? Yes. Would he say the plain, blunt truth? Yes. Would he try to hurt people? No. He would get mad at the Pharisees, say, "You're children of hell." He would say things straight, pointed, to the point, no compromise. But when he was dealing with the sheep, he was very, very tender-hearted. I mean, he's dealing with the woman found in adultery. He said, "Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Go and don't sin this sin anymore." She's going to be a sinner. He's not saying, "Go and don't ever sin again." That's not what he's talking about. Don't do this sin again. It takes a long time to come to a place of understanding how you're supposed to live as a believer. You don't arrive there overnight. Have you noticed that? And he says, add to your faith knowledge, to knowledge temperance, temperance patience, hupomone. And that's the noun form of endure. They that endure to the end, hupomeno, and the trying of your faith works patience. So if you're wanting to be stabilized in your election, go through the fire. It takes years of going through fire. And to patience, godliness, eusebia, being devout to God and being godly, godliness, and to godliness, brotherly kindness, philosadelphos, and to brotherly kindness, charity, walking in God's commandments. That's agape. If these things be in you, these seven things, and they abound in you, they're just overabounding. This, you have all this virtue, this maturity. How long is it going to take to add these seven things? That's going to be years and years and years and years. You want to grow up and do it overnight? I'm sorry, but you can't do it. They make you that ye shall neither be barren nor unfruitful in the fruit of the Spirit. In the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ, he that lacketh these things is blind. He's not talking about goats. He's talking about a baby sheep, a lamb, that doesn't have these seven things. He's blind and he's staggering around and cannot see very far. And he's forgotten that he's already been purged of his old sins. He's saying, if you're a baby believer, you've forgotten that you were purged, even though you were. And then he says, wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence by adding these seven things to your life. It's going to take time. Make your calling and election stabilized. People want to, they want too much. They want to grow up fast. And he says, make your calling and election sure, for if you do these things, you shall never fall. But how long is it going to take to get this strong? A long time. This is our faith growing. For so an entrance shall be ministered. An entrance into God's kingdom. The word entrance is eisodos. 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 It comes from east, meaning in, and hodos. It means the way in to the kingdom of God is being ministered epikoregeo. When he says add to your faith epikoregeo, he says this is being put into you over time, ministered unto you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is a process of growing. We're elected to obey God, to die daily, to get rid of that outer man, and quit thinking that we can live the way we want to live. You're not your own. You're bought with a price. Well, I'm going to keep living this way. You know what a lot of people think? Weak believers have said this to me. Well, I've got this desire, so God must want me to do it. Well, everybody here has sexual urges. Do you believe that God wants you to go out here and sleep with everybody you can? Huh?
No.
No. Sin is fun. Since sin is so much fun, do you think God wants you to go down here to the Starlight Club and flirt with a bunch of women and get drunk? Since it's fun, well, God put this in me, so he must want me to do it. No, he put it in every human being, and he's calling us out of it. And he'll wear every one of us out. Wear you out. I'll wear you out, God says, until you surrender to me and say, oh, God, don't hit me again. Let's pray. Father, thank you for truth. Help us to realize what our election is unto. We've been chosen by you to live holy and godly and righteously. Lord, I pray that you'll help me to teach this so I can get this message over. And I know I can. It has to be the Holy Spirit. Give me the clearest words possible so people can learn. Thank you for truth. Lead us to your elect. Open up many doors for this ministry. We'll praise you for everything. In Christ's name, amen. Boy, I went in many directions tonight. Hey, Rusty, how you doing?
I love you, man.
I love you, too.
Thank you for being who you are.
Thank you for being who you are, too. Thank you. I love you, brother.